What's the line from The Edge? Come on, call us, join the party. Oh, 940-40-40.
What are we going to talk about?
We should talk about Hot Gossip Party Line and that era of late night New Zealand advertising.
Magic times. We're just warming up.
Warming up with some of the old favourite topics.
Yeah. Sam.
James.
Welcome. Hi.
Are you tired? I'm a little bit
tired. I'm buggered. Yeah, can you remember meeting me for the first time?
Yes, and it was in Christchurch. It was at a Christchurch institution at the university. We were playing one of those student union shows where they had the wedges with sour cream and sweet chili sauce or whatever on your on your study break.
The Foundry.
The Foundry.
Yeah. I remember we met on the banks of the river and you had just turned up and didn't...
Our gear hadn't shown up.
You and Luke were playing trippy guitar.
Sort of ambient dub funk.
Yeah, but you had no effects pedals. Yeah.
Just real classic gigging scenario. We did a bunch of those shows. Remember we did one once that was sponsored by Herbal Highs? The whole band got given free...
Herbal Highs.
Herbal Highs. Some that were like basically speed and some that were like ecstasy. Some of us took one and some of us took the other. And we had this really horrible gig where some of us were kind of going, oh, this feels so special. And the other ones are going like, my brain is going to fry. But they were legal.
Yeah.
Have you got a worst gig, James?
Yeah, I've got a few. My worst gigs involve having some kind of mental meltdown on stage.
Right.
There was one gig at the Odeon Lounge and people were talking and I was just wanted some degree of attention. And I just remember basically, you know, screaming at the people in the audience to shut up and then storming off.
I can totally understand. It can feel really fucking deflating when you're like pouring your heart into something and you can just hear people talking about bullshit right in front of you.
Like, I'm an introvert and I'm quite quietly spoken and I was always really... intoxicated by the idea that you could grab someone's attention using music.
Without having to be some loudmouth.
Or be handsome or, you know, well, I'm obviously very handsome, but, you know, devastatingly charming and magnetic.
You're being the centre of attention because you've worked really hard on something that you want to share with people.
Yeah.
It's worth sharing. Die a Woman.
There's something about the chords of that song that's, you know, the I don't have the musical theory to describe what happens, but there's so many songs that I could have chosen, but that period of your music still holds magic to me because it's associated with that time in my life. But it's funny how you know, the emotions you experience when you're just exploding out into the world, they linger with you a lot, and so, you know, those songs really sit with me.
My people, they just sighed. They said, our king, he is suffering. These could be
One of those songs that I felt like was quite a breakthrough for me in terms of being able to write a song.
Yeah.
And I was writing really terrible songs before then. They were just so shit. Lyrically lame and I don't know, like if our first EP is so bad, I think. And then Charming Van and Let Me Die a Woman were like the two songs where I was kind of like, oh, I think I might
you've
actually
achieved
have a little angle.
Something that's transcendent. How do you feel about COVID-19?
I think it was it's a bad thing.
It's a bad idea.
COVID-19 was a bad idea.
Yeah.
I think I'm quite an extrovert.
Yeah.
And I really need like random interactions with strangers and being in crowds and things like that. And I felt quite unhinged. You and Anne's reached out to me at some point because I was on social media so much.
Is this a cry for help?
Yeah, and it was.
Yeah.
But it also was like, well, that's all I could do.
Yeah, that's the only way you can connect with people. As far as working as a musician and being a parent goes, like, I do envy people with day jobs just because the delineation is so much clearer between work and parenting. And parenting is by necessity so involving and it consumes your brain a lot. So I think it's been pretty challenging being the sort of freelance, work at home some of the time, dad, kind of torn between, you know, this kind of pretty nebulous career, which is just, you know, be creative.
Yeah.
Like it's hard to, I just need to be creative for a while, darling.
Well, sometimes you need to be like useless for 2 hours before you can start being creative.
Yeah. But no, you just need to be creative now.
Yeah, that was hilarious though when our kids were arguing over who was more famous out of their dads.
It got quite heated. It's quite hard to explain to small people how that kind of thing works.
Yeah, and just how embarrassing the whole conversation is because it was like...
And that basically neither of us are...
Actually famous.
Famous at all. The creative mindset, or the way I experience it anyway, is the opposite of organisation, of cleanliness, of anything that, you know, being a good parent and a good housekeeper. If you were going to make a really cool album, you'd be up till 4:30 in the morning smoking drugs.
But wouldn't it be so great if it was legal and you could go to a shop and say, like, I need some weed that's going to make me high for, like, an hour but not have a big come down and I'm not going to get so high that I'm going to, like, freak out and worry about...
I've got some very difficult parenting to do at about 4 o'clock.
Yeah, I just need to be a little bit buzzed.
But I want to make some kind of psychedelic music between now and, you know, say 3 o'clock. Was that your call?
It was my call. I mean, I do love that song. There's a thing about bicycle riding that is very specific to the way I hear it. For me, bicycle riding is set in World War II, potentially in London or somewhere. And it, to me, I picture kids going out riding their bikes in amongst ruins, basically bombed out London. And I don't know why it triggers that image for me, but it does every time. And I actually had this thought that maybe I'd write another verse which made that more explicit, but obviously I'm too lazy and didn't get around to doing that.
But were you thinking of adding an extra Sam Penn verse for the...
Yeah, I thought that would be a really weird move.
I like that. Unconventional.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen very often in covers. You don't often append new parts to the work.
No.
Yeah,
I like can't that. Think of any instances.
Girls in the morning.
Looking at the merchandise my girlfriend Anne's did of you guys for your last record, I was just, these line drawings. I have to say that Tom is the most conventionally handsome member of the Phoenix Foundation.
He's probably got the least round face.
He's just got this very symmetrical, I never realised what a hunky is. It's a shame Tom isn't here.
New Zealand music survivor. I don't know, like who's crafty?
I mean, I think of New Zealand musicians, and you look around at those people and you think they wouldn't do that well.
No, they wouldn't really survive in the bush conditions. Well, I wouldn't. I'd die.
Yeah, I think there would be a lot of deaths. I feel comfortable in that community, a community of people who are weaklings.
Weak, not outdoorsy types.
Yeah. Why are we going on about what an amazing community we are when actually... we're all miserable bunch of depressives who sit at home alone, agonising over our work and never talking to anyone. I think I feel more comfortable among those people, maybe because they're not really a huge threat to me in terms of, you know, mating.
It's nice that we're getting to chat, not on Zoom.
Life's busy. We don't get to see each other that often. So if it takes being... forced together into a room with a bunch of cameras and lights, then all the better.
Yeah, but it's interesting though, being like sat down to have a conversation with someone who you like having conversations with, but all of a sudden you're in conversation prison. It's good.
But I think it was something that I would, you know, happily repeat.
Without cameras?
I mean, yeah, without cameras, of course. I'll just give you a call.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah.
That'd be good. In fact, I think like once they turn all the cameras off, can we just...
We can keep chatting.
Keep chatting, maybe have a cup of tea.
Yeah, that'd be nice.